about the constitutionality of Section 2, which I think you were referring to earlier, of the Voting Rights Act. He testified, quote, "I have no basis for viewing Section 2 as constitutionally suspect, and I don't." Judge Barrett, do you agree that Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act is constitutional?
I think that Chief Justice Roberts' statement, "I have no basis for viewing it as constitutionally suspect," would be the same as mine. I'm not aware of any constitutional law existing that would create a question about it.
Thank you. As Senator Hirono mentioned yesterday, in a 2018 case before the Supreme Court, a group of workers were denied overtime pay and joined together to file a lawsuit against their employer. The corporation argued that workers didn't have a right to go to court as a group and could only raise disputes in arbitration individually.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is, and it is a Wednesday, and Kamala Harris is speaking now in the third day of the confirmation hearings for Amy Coney Barrett to the Supreme Court. So Kamala Harris is about, 5 minutes into it. I thought we would listen to her for a while. First thing to let you know is the first night when they each did their 10 minutes opening remarks, her audio was horrible. They fixed it yesterday, but it's all foobar again today. Yeah, just thought I'd let you know. It's not me, it's her. It's the Senate.
Congress's passage of labor laws to protect workers and place them on equal footing. Do you recognize Justice Ginsburg's point that there is, quote, extreme imbalance of power between large corporations and individual workers?
Senator Harris, I'm going to give you
the I'm not going to give you a view
you with respect to
I won't give you any views.
You quoted me from
I'm an
Justice
android
Roberts' opinion in Shelby County that I just I'm not going to
I'm not going to express my views on any
or
issue
embracing portions of opinions, especially opinions that have been recently decided and are contentious from the court.
So I will not give you my opinion.
And, you know, you've been on the bench a short time, but I'm going to just point out that I do believe, and commentators have noted, a pattern that you've had of ruling against workers and in favor of corporations.
Yes, she does. She
For example, in Berlaca v. Contact Transportation Services, you ruled against long-haul truckers
Ooh.
Seeking overtime pay for additional work.
That's not good.
In Wallace v. Grubhub Holdings, you ruled against delivery drivers seeking overtime pay, forcing them out of court and into private arbitration.
Uh-huh.
In Harris v. YRC Worldwide, you ruled against four black truck drivers who alleged their employer assigned them less desirable routes.
Oh, no.
When compared to their colleagues. And Smith v. Illinois Department of Transportation,
Whoops.
You ruled against a black worker who was called a racial slur by his supervisor.
Yeah, because that didn't create a hostile workplace.
On, according to an independent analysis of your decisions, Judge, it appears you have sided with business interests over workers and consumers in about 85%
Uh-oh.
Of your business-related cases.
Uh-oh.
Moving on, climate change, as many have mentioned, is an existential threat, and its effects are all around us. In California, we've had 5 of the 6 largest wildfires in the state's history. 31 people have been killed by wildfires in California since August.
But she doesn't really believe, she doesn't have an opinion on climate change.
And a helicopter pilot. Across the state, over 9,000 homes and structures have been burned, and Californians have been forced to breathe dangerous smoke. All of this, obviously, during a pandemic which attacks the respiratory system. But rather than work to combat climate change, the Trump administration has rolled back environmental protections and removed the word, the term climate change from government agency websites, including the EPA. In 2007, in Massachusetts versus EPA, the Supreme Court decided by a 5-4 ruling that states could sue the EPA for its failure to combat climate change during the Bush administration. Justice Ginsburg was the crucial 5th vote in that case. Following that ruling, the EPA responded by unequivocally finding that climate change and its impacts are a danger to the public health and welfare. Justice Barrett, yesterday you said that, quote, you have read things about climate change, but you would not say you have firm views on it, unquote. In response to Senator Blumenthal today, you said, quote, you are not competent to opine on what causes global warming and that you, quote, don't think your views on global warming or climate change are relevant to the work you do as a judge. I certainly do believe your views are relevant, and I'm very concerned about your statements. Since the Massachusetts v. EPA case, scientific consensus has grown even more and stronger that climate change is real. And
so we are listening to Senator Kamala Harris right now, ostensibly questioning Amy Coney Barrett. Instead, she's lecturing her. But, you know, Amy Coney Barrett's not answering any questions, so lecturing works. Here we go.
To scientists and those with expertise in the relevant issues before rendering a judgment.
Will you defer to scientists?
If the case comes before me involving environmental regulation, I will certainly apply all applicable laws.
I will apply all applicable laws.
And as I'm sure you know, Senator Harris, the Administrative Procedure Act does require courts to defer to agency fact-finding and to agency regulations.
I am a robot.
Supported by substantial evidence. So, yes, I would apply that law and defer when the law
A Republican who said she would defer to scientists.
Do you accept that COVID-19 is infectious?
I will not give an opinion on that.
I accept that COVID-19 is infectious.
Wow.
That's something of which I feel like, you know, we could say you take judicial notice of. It's an obvious fact, yes.
It's an obvious fact.
Do you accept that smoking causes cancer?
I'm not sure exactly where you're going with this, but you know the notice that smoking
causes cancer. The question
is what it is. You can answer it if you believe. Yes or no,
Senator Harris? Yes, every package of cigarettes warns that smoking causes cancer.
Okay.
And do you believe that climate change is happening and is threatening the air we breathe and the water we drink?
Senator, again, I was wondering where you were going with that. You have asked me a series of questions like. That are completely uncontroversial, like whether COVID-19 is infectious.
That's right. So answer them.
Whether smoking causes cancer, yep. And then trying to analogize that to eliciting an opinion on me that is a very contentious matter, opinion from me that is on a very contentious matter of
climate
public
change?
Debate. And I will not do that.
Oh my God. I will not give an opinion.
Public policy, especially one that is politically controversial because that's inconsistent with the judicial role, as I have explained.
Thank you. Thank you, Judge Barrett. And you've made your point clear that you believe it's a debatable point.
It's Mr.
Chairman,
she does. She believes climate change is a debatable point.
In the eyes of the people of our country.
It does.
Americans are right now suffering from a deadly pandemic, and we are also suffering a historic economic crisis.
True that.
The Senate should be working day and night to provide economic relief to families. And not rushing a Supreme Court confirmation. We are also in the middle of an election.
Yeah, we are.
More than 12 million Americans have already voted. The American people want whomever wins this election to fill this seat. My Republican colleagues know that, I believe. This hearing has done nothing to alleviate the concerns raised about why this nominee was chosen and why this is being rushed when the American people deserve to be heard. So again, I would say, let us not pretend that we don't know what consequences rushing this confirmation will have for the American people. There are countless issues at stake, and to be candid, people are very, very scared. They are scared that allowing President Trump to jam this confirmation through would roll back rights for generations, scared about what it means to the future of voting rights, about what it means for civil rights, for workers' rights, for consumer rights, for climate change, and the right to a safe and legal abortion, not to mention access to health care regardless of income or pre-existing conditions. They are also deeply concerned about what this means for our nation's continued pursuit of the timeless principle, equal justice under law. And I share those concerns. Sadly, my Senate Republican colleagues are doing, I believe, great harm with this illegitimate process. And if they are successful, it has the potential to do great damage. And I believe that damage is to the people of our country and to the United States Supreme Court. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Kamala Harris. And there you go. And we've had enough of that. We will not be listening to Lindsey Graham or to John Kennedy. Boy, talk about taking a name and not living up to its legacy. All right, so there you have it. Senator Kamala Harris doing her questioning of Amy Coney Barrett in day three of the Supreme Court's Senate Judiciary Committee hearing into Kamala Harris, into Amy Coney Barrett's nomination. I'm so over this. I feel, you ever get the feeling like everything is stacked against you? And I'm not playing the victim here, just that I feel like everything is stacked against us. And it's really sad. We shouldn't be here. To whoever called before and I hung up on you, feel free to call back now. I was just, unfortunately, that phone, I need to start Skype up again. The phone bank comes in on the same pot that the video from the hearing came in on, and so I couldn't have two things going on there at the same time. So whoever it was calling me, I hung up on. So if you're still there, if you're not mad at me, you can call back. Or I can call him back, but, you know, we'll see if he's still listening. Again, I apologize for hanging up on you. There is, today's What's News is a lot about what happened yesterday in the hearing. And I guess I can bring you that. Let me let you know that at the bottom of the hour, we're going to be joined by Lisa Graves. If you've listened to this show for any amount of time, you know Lisa Graves. She is the person I know who has the best credentials to comment on what happened today. All right, I see our caller is back. So, hi, first of all, sorry about hanging up on you. Who's this?
Hey, this is Ryan. It's been a while since I've called your show.
Okay, hi, Ryan. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Fairfax, Virginia.
Okay. So what's on your mind today? Now, you watching these hearings at all?
What's on my mind is I voted today.
Yay!
I'm excited about it.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
As much as I want Donald Trump out of office,
yeah,
I don't think Biden is the guy.
But so did you vote for Trump?
No, I voted for Jurgensen.
Why? You know that you voted for Trump. Of any vote that wasn't for Joe Biden is a vote for Donald Trump, and you're an idiot. Joe Biden's not the guy. I agree with
Jared Conley.
Okay, excuse me. Joe Biden is not the guy. I agree with you. But given a choice between Joe Biden and Donald Trump, and that was the only choice we had in this election, one of those two men is going to win the election on November 3rd. And instead, you threw away your vote, ostensibly giving it to Donald Trump, and you say you don't want Donald Trump to win. Joe Biden is a placeholder. And hopefully Kamala Harris will become president very soon. I'm not a big Kamala Harris fan either, but after listening to her the last 2 days, number one, I was impressed, and number two, she'll kick some ass. What is your problem?
I'm gonna tell you why. I had to struggle with this one.
Yeah.
Because I read all three policies.
Jorgensen doesn't have a policy. Jorgensen doesn't count. He's nothing but a spoiler. And you've thrown your vote away. You feel really good about that?
Jorgensen
has no chance of winning. Has no chance of winning. Has no chance of winning. So you've.
Are we going to continue? I mean, but listen here. I mean, you know, not to argue about anything, but we have to really sit back and look at this for a large scale. We're really voting for stopgapping. The two parties are not really going to get anything done. They're just going to hold an ass in the seat.
Mm-hmm.
All you're going to have is Biden basically sitting there with
Alzheimer's
disease.
Fuck you with Alzheimer's disease. His mind is more sharp than Donald Trump's on his best day. You know, you're buying the right-wing propaganda, so what's your fucking problem? Excuse me?
Here is an asinine guy in the White House.
Yeah, so you're voting to keep him there, to keep his crooks and criminals propping up his family business, just trashing the Constitution and any norm and law that ever existed in this country. You're tossing that out the window. You threw away your vote.
I mean, I like Mark Warner and I like Jared Conley. I love those two.
Okay.
Those are my favorite Democrats. So I did vote for them.
But, wow.
You know, we here in Virginia, we actually vote early.
Yeah, I voted. I already voted. I voted already, but I voted for the guy who can take the office from Donald Trump. I didn't throw away my vote.
But, you know, I sat back for hours and read all three persons' policies.
That's where you made your first mistake, because Jorgensen doesn't have a chance in hell. By voting for him, you threw away your vote, which basically passed a vote for Donald Trump.
The two tyrants have monopolized the geographical, political voting base.
Okay, you know what? You're a fucking moron, and I hope you don't listen to the show anymore. Go away. I'm sorry. He's threatening my future. He's threatening your future. He's thrown away a vote. And every vote counts. If you think I was wrong, let me know. Phone lines are open, 954-889-6410. Frankly, I don't think I was harsh enough, because I held back. There's no excuse right now. He may as well have written in Jill Stein. Seriously, any vote for anybody for president, Whoops. Hi, who's this? Whoops, you gotta turn down the radio because there's an echo.
Yeah, I just turned it off. Oh, sorry about that.
That's okay.
There's no excuse right now.
I was kind of pissed. Yeah.
I called to say, calm yourself down. This is Pam from San Bernardino.
Hi, Pam.
I voted straight D.
Good for you.
And I took my ballot into the election office and delivered it yesterday.
Good for you.
So, you know, I'm a Bernie girl.
Me too.
And like you, you said you were going to use your industrial nose to vote for Biden.
Got him right here.
I didn't have to do that. I looked at the future of everybody, including my two grandkids, who are precious to me.
Yep.
Healthcare and everything else, our standing in the world, the unlawfulness of this president who has no respect for the Constitution or the law, his cronies in the Senate, and I know of people who died to give me the right to vote.
Exactly.
So I cast the vote.
Thank you.
For Biden, straight down the ticket, all these, because we need not only the presidency, the Senate, the House. We also need to look at our local officials
absolutely.
As well. Absolutely. Straight vote. Calm yourself down. Don't let that idiot make you upset.
Thank you. Hey, let me ask you something. You're in San Bernardino. Is your member of Congress? Are you in Liam O'Malley's district?
No. My guy is Pete Aguilar.
Oh, okay. All right. Because Liam O'Malley is really good. He's in the 42nd district. I think he's out around Riverside. So not too far from you. Liam O'Mara. Sorry. Liam O'Mara.
But if Putin doesn't interfere with our elections, as he did in 2016, it's going to be a blue wave. So we'll see, and you'll be raising that glass of champagne.
Absolutely. Oh, we're going to have exactly.
So you have a wonderful rest of the show.
thank you
for what you do, and don't let the idiots get you upset.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the call. Really appreciate it. You see, that's a patriot. And that's somebody who knows that this is what we need to do. If you want to, ensure the future of a nation, well, then you vote for somebody who can actually win, who can get the tyrant out of power. I see someone's calling from the Tampa Bay area. Hi, who's this? Hello?
This is Tony in Tampa.
Tony in Tampa. Hello? Hi, Tony in Tampa. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, we've got a weird connection.
All right, I can call back. I'm sorry.
Okay, all right, sorry. It sounds like maybe Tony wasn't talking into the phone receiver. You can't do speakerphone thing when you're calling in. So, you know, look, I checked today. We took our ballots in on Saturday, the three ballots, David's, Allison's, and mine, and we dropped them off at the Broward County Supervisor of Elections office. Well, and you can do this wherever you are in the country. You can check on the status of your ballot. So if you already mailed it in, go to your county registrar's office or supervisor of elections office, the website. You don't have to visit them in person. don't risk the COVID. And you can check. And in Florida, in Broward County, you can check right online. All three of our ballots were accepted and they were counted. So we're done. It is October 14th. So, you know, election day is November 3rd. All right. I'll tell you what. So our friend in Tampa, Tony's not calling back. Let's do this. A quick timeout on the Progressive Voices Network. We'll be right back. And for everyone else, I guess I'll start with the news because there's obviously a lot going on today. And a lot of it has been sort of preempted because of the hearing. I got to tell you, you know, I hope you heard Laffy yesterday because she was very funny. And the voice she came up with for Amy Coney Barrett was quite good. She has the high register thing going. You know, I've got more of the deep voice. But what I noticed last night in listening to her is she speaks very staccato, like she's almost like a conehead, like an alien, like a robot. She's an android, except I have an android and I kind of like it. She's an iPhone. Yeah, you know, just saying. I know it's childish. It's okay. We can be childish every now and again. All right. So let me look at, there's other news other than the hearing, because we're going to get Lisa Graves on the line in about 10 minutes. So I'll save the hearing stuff for her. So let me tell you about a few other things. The Supreme Court, which is already, it's a 5-3 court right now with only 8 justices, because John Roberts, although he sided with the liberals in the last couple of decisions, is a Bush appointee. He's not one of us. Well, the court offered a harbinger of things to come, in a sense, yesterday. They ruled to allow the Trump administration to stop the census count. Now, an appeals court had already ruled that the counting must continue through the end of October. Already not to the end of the year, but you understand, Donald Trump wants to rush this so that he can do, you know, the Republicans can deal with the redistricting before he leaves office, before they all get voted out. That's why they want to rush the census through. So an appeals court said, oh no, we're going to extend it till October 31st. Well, yesterday the Supreme Court said, no, we're going to shut it down now. So basically, if you have not responded to the census yet, go to census.gov. Do it today because it ends tomorrow night, actually at 11:59 Hawaii time. I think that's very early in the morning here on Friday, but you know, don't wait. Do it now. All right. Looks like our friend Tony is back. Tony, you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, that's much
Sorry
better.
About that.
Much better. What's on your mind?
Oh man, this guy pissed me off so bad.
Good. So it wasn't just me.
Right. You know, I used to be in the military. I was in the Marine Corps, and I went to Desert Storm and I fought for this nation. But here's the problem with what that guy's saying is that people all the time tell me, oh, thank you for your service. Thank you for your service. Whenever they see me, I got my hat on or whatever. And I always ask them, I said, did you vote?
Mm-hmm.
They tell me, they thank me for my service. I ask them immediately, hey, did you vote or do you vote? When they go, no, I said, then my service meant nothing.
Right.
So you have to vote. So that's what I tell people. And this guy, they threw their votes away on Jill Stein, who I think was actually working with Russia also.
Could have been.
And she's just a spoiler.
Yeah. I mean, I have more respect for the Green Party than I do for Jill Stein. I just think they're a party without anything. They show up every 4 years to be a spoiler in the presidential election. If they kept it going year round and really tried to be like the new Progressive Party, maybe they could build on some momentum. But they just show up every 4 years and say, all right, we're running someone for president. Well, don't be a spoiler. That doesn't help
Absolutely.
Anybody. Right.
Yeah, don't stick your head up every 4 years and go, hey, we're here, give us some votes. No, mm-hmm. you haven't done anything between those 4 years to try to gather those voters.
Mm-hmm.
And this is so important that every single person goes out and vote. I got to run, but I got to tell you, I love your show.
Oh, thank
I love you.
You.
And you keep doing what you're doing. I support you 100%.
Thank you so much, Tony. Great to hear from you. I'm glad you called All back. Right. Thanks. Bye-bye. Thanks. And that's so true. Look. You know, my daughter got to vote for the first time. I told you, she moved out a month or so ago still killing me. She came over one night. It was a week ago Thursday. Was it just last week? God, it feels like forever, but it was horrible. I couldn't touch her. I couldn't hug her. We have the masks on. We have the face shields on. We have the gloves on. I can't give her a hug. When she finally left, one, I was relieved, and two, I cried. What we're going through is just unimaginable. Can you think back a year ago? Would you ever have thought that we'd be suffering from a global pandemic and, you know, we couldn't walk out of our houses without wearing a face mask? Let me bring back our friends from Progressive Voices, because I didn't want to forget about them again. Welcome back, Progressive Voices listeners. All right, so we're talking about the vote and the call we got a little while ago with this guy, Ryan. You know, look, maybe I was a bit harsh, but I'm sorry. This is not the time for fooling around. We have a choice to make. And do I hate that we have a two-party system in this country? Yes. But be realistic. This is a binary choice. It's going to be Donald Trump or it's going to be Joe Biden. And the fact that he started bringing the bullshit about, you know, oh, the Alzheimer's, stop it. Joe Biden is a hell of a lot more lucid on his worst day than Donald Trump is on his best. And for Donald Trump to be making age jokes about Joe Biden's 3 years older than him. Donald Trump is an old fart. Joe Biden's at least in decent shape. He can ride a bicycle. Donald Trump can't walk up a flight of stairs. But I digress. Please don't throw your vote away. We have, each of us has one vote, or we're supposed to. Some people are standing in line for 11 hours. In Georgia, they're standing in line for 11 hours. And you throw your vote away for Jorgensen? I have no words. All right, so I was telling you about what else is in the news. The Supreme Court showing us how stacked it is against us already. They also made another ruling yesterday. They shut down a lawsuit on emoluments brought by 215 Democrats from the House and Senate. 215 congressional Democrats brought a lawsuit basically saying that this president is bilking the American people. He's violating the emoluments clause. And the justices refused to hear their appeal by finding that the lawmakers lacked legal standing to bring the case. Well, legal standing, I guess, because it's about Trump's hotel in D.C., where he's bilking taxpayers. He's taking money. He's making money off the office of the presidency. But basically, I guess, to have legal standing, and I can ask Lisa Graves about this when she joins us, maybe those who can bring the case are perhaps other hotel owners in the D.C. area. Apparently, there are still two similar lawsuits coming. One is from an advocacy group, and the other is Democratic attorneys general. But I don't trust this 5-3 Supreme Court, to be fair, and I certainly wouldn't trust a 6-3 Supreme Court with Amy Coney Barrett on it. I got to tell you, I was so impressed. The reason I started today's show with Kamala Harris, because she was so good last night, and they saved her last night for prime time, which was really smart. And it just comes out that way. Kamala Harris is a junior senator, and they go in order of seniority. Now, I guess she could have come before Cory Booker, and I could be totally wrong here, but I think when it comes to they're both in the same class, they go alphabetical. The only thing I can figure. But it worked out great. It worked out so I had her on at the beginning of the show today, and that we had her on, you know, at dinner last night. And she was so good last night that I actually thought about playing her entire half-hour presentation, because she really didn't ask Amy Coney Barrett many questions. Instead, she schooled her. She schooled her. She took her through what's at stake if we lose this seat, and what's at stake if the Supreme Court overturns the Affordable Care Act. Here's a little bit, a very little bit of that.
After suffering the backlash that they provoked by targeting the law in Congress, they decided instead to circumvent voters and try to strike down the Affordable Care Act through the courts. Right now, The Trump administration and Senate Republicans are urging the Supreme Court to strike down the entire Affordable Care Act and all of its patient protections. Republicans are scrambling to confirm this nominee as fast as possible because they need one more Trump judge on the bench before November 10th to win and strike down the entire Affordable Care Act.
Yep.
This is not hyperbole.
Nope.
This is not a hypothetical.
No, it isn't. This is
this
real life.
This is happening. And here's what you have to know. People are scared. People are scared of what will happen if the Affordable Care Act is destroyed.
I am.
In the middle of a pandemic.
I am.
There are more than 100 million Americans with pre-existing conditions like asthma and diabetes, heart disease,
yep,
who know that they could be denied coverage, are charged more by insurance companies if Donald Trump is successful in getting rid of the Affordable Care Act.
That's right.
And because of the coronavirus, more than 7 million people have now a pre-existing condition that they didn't have earlier this year. Those who depend on the ACA are afraid of their lives being turned upside down if the court strikes it down.
Yep.
They know what could happen.
So 4 years ago, this Saturday, I returned to the air after taking off a few months because of surgery, because I was diagnosed with lung cancer and I had to get most of my left lung removed. Now, I'm one of the lucky ones. We caught my cancer really early. So it was two tumors, removed the whole bottom lobe of my left lung and did what they call a wedge resection of the upper lobe because they were two separate and distinct tumors. So if one didn't kill me, the other one would have. Had we not caught it early, and we caught it early because I thought I was having a heart attack. And when I went to the hospital and they did an x-ray, it showed a mass on my lung. Otherwise, what the doctors told me is people, you know, often they don't, because you don't have symptoms, they don't discover it until it's too late. Well, I got lucky. But I had this major surgery and I was off the air for a few months. And I'm like talking to the Progressive Voices people and said, I got to get back on the air. Donald Trump is running for president. I can't just sit on the sidelines. 4 years ago, this Saturday, I returned to the air. And I feel more helpless today than I did then. Because I get calls from people saying, you know, I'm voting for the Libertarian. You know what? I don't care if you don't like Joe Biden. He's a placeholder. He is the generic D who can get Donald Trump out of office and return some semblance of normalcy to our government. And look, I'm an abnormal person. I'm normally not the one to go with the norms, right? I break rules. I always have. I don't play by anyone's rule book. I march to the beat of my own drummer. But right now, we need to get together for the sake of the nation and remove the criminal. Get rid of the guy who wants to kill us. You see, that's what it comes down to. Yeah, neither one of them is great, but let's get rid of the guy who actively wants to kill us. All right, so I told you we have a guest coming on, and I'm so happy to welcome back to the program my old friend Lisa Graves. Now, if you've listened to the show for a while, you know who Lisa is. She's got the credentials. Hey, Lisa Graves, you there?
I am. Yeah. I am. So nice to see you.
Oh, so nice to have you here. I'm watching these hearings and I'm cringing and I just like, who can I talk to about this? I'm like, oh my God, Lisa Graves not only worked for the Senate Judiciary Committee, you were the chief counsel for nominations under Patrick Leahy. So did you deal with Supreme Court nominees?
I did not. I've dealt with all the other nominees, and I prepared the briefing book for the event of having a Supreme Court nominee, but I left the Senate in 2005, early in the year before the vacancies arose. When I was the chief counsel for nominations, I worked on a number of nominations that were people who we thought President Bush would be likely to try to make Supreme Court justice, and if they had records of unfairness, I worked to make the case for why they should not be confirmed. Huh. I one of the people who I fought hard from getting confirmed to the D.C. Circuit was John Roberts. Ultimately, I was unsuccessful in my efforts to say that I didn't think that he should become a judge, let alone ultimately a Supreme Court justice and the chief of the Supreme Court. But when I left, I had told people that if President Bush had the opportunity, I believed that John Roberts would be the first nomination he would make, which is why I asked the United States Senate leadership not to have a recorded vote on the nomination of John Roberts, because I did not want senators to have been on the record having voted for his nomination if he were renominated. I wanted them to have a clean slate chance to vote against them if he were the one nominated, and he was.
Wow, interesting. Now, he was not a lawyer for very long before Bush nominated him to the Supreme Court, right? And I'm going somewhere with this, because neither was Amy Coney Barrett.
Well, Roberts had been a lawyer for not quite, I guess, more than 20 years.
Oh, really? Okay.
But Brett Kavanaugh had not been a lawyer for very long when he was first nominated to the same court, the D.C. Circuit. And so Roberts had more experience than Kavanaugh did, but he had very little experience as a judge before he was nominated to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Now, Amy Coney Barrett, on the other hand, was a law professor, right? It did Donald Trump like pluck her out of obscurity in Notre Dame to put her on the Seventh Court of Appeals?
No. In fact, there's new evidence that shows that she was handpicked by Leonard Leo, who was the vice president of the Federal Society and now is the co-chair of the Federal Society, in April and May of 2017, after Neil Gorsuch was confirmed. Leonard Leo started maneuvers to get her added to the list of Supreme Court candidates. As you may recall, Trump had announced an earlier list that Leonard Leo helped him draw up. And that summer and fall, Leonard Leo met with Donald Trump and met with him for dinner and urged him to add Amy Barrett to his list. And he did. And then he chose her. And so in that same time frame, that's when Leonard Leo was also advising the president on who should get these lower court appointments in order to touch the base, basically, of having some minimal judicial experience before they are before someone's elevated. And Amy Coney Barrett was confirmed to a Seventh Circuit seat that fall at the urging, in essence, of Leonard Leo. And that seat was also a seat that had been held vacant by Mitch McConnell for more than a year during the last year of President Obama's administration. A black judge, a woman, Myra Powell, who was the first African-American woman to sit on the Indiana Supreme Court, a woman and person who had excellent experience as a judge, a lengthy experience as a judge, and a record of fairness, was blocked from being confirmed to that seat. And then Amy Coney Barrett was chosen to take that seat in preparation for, I think, Leonard Leo's efforts to put her on the U.S. Supreme Court, which is what we're in the process of witnessing right now.
It's unbelievable. So she only has, from if my research is correct, if what I heard is right, she's never been a trial lawyer. She's only been a judge for 3 years, and now she's going to be on the Supreme Court. Is this normal?
Well, she's been a judge for less than 3 years.
Okay.
To be technical about it,
yes.
Since that's the rule of the day, apparently,
yes,
in this confirmation hearing. But she had some experience in big firm private practice as an associate, but she's not someone who's known for being a trial lawyer or even an appellate lawyer. So she's someone who, does not have an extensive record of having that experience. And in fact, her very minimal record of being on the Seventh Circuit in that time frame looks like an audition in many ways for this job to become a Supreme Court justice. In her speeches, many speeches at Federal Society, I think it's more than a dozen times since she became a judge, she's suddenly flying around the country to Federal Society events. I guess being an appellate judge is a pretty sweet gig. You have all this time to head off to multi-day events to hang out with your Federal Society buddies and give them speeches, where she's readily giving her views on all sorts of things as part of those speeches. And then suddenly before the American people in these hearings, she's clammed up and can't say anything about anything, including whether intimidating voters is illegal.
Right. She would not express a view on, if it's legal to intimidate voters at the polls. You know, she wouldn't say if she'll recuse herself. She won't say if Donald Trump can pardon himself. I mean, the things she would not express a view on. It just tick off another one and another one. And I understand that this is kind of precedent that they don't go there. But Kamala Harris last night, I thought, did a great job with her, where she got her to, after praising Ruth Bader Ginsburg, she also said, you keep quoting her, but actually Ruth Bader Ginsburg was quite clear that a woman should have every right to choose what happens with her body. And, Amy Coney Barrett liked to quote Ruth Bader Ginsburg when it suited her, but she sure clammed up there.
Well, and I think that, this hearing has revealed just how disingenuous Amy Barrett is, how slippery she is, basically how determined she is to not say to this committee her actual views. When in fact, she was chosen for this position, not because she has a demonstrated record of fairness as a judge. She barely has a record of being a judge, but because she has impressed upon Leonard Leo and the supporters, the basically men advising the president, that she will be a sure thing, that she'll be a sure vote for them in their agenda. And the president has made quite clear what his agenda is. It's to overturn Roe versus Wade. It's to destroy the Affordable Care Act. Mm-hmm. And in his rallies and other statements, it's to basically issue a ruling from the bench, from the Supreme Court, that would keep him in the White House and stop Americans' votes from being counted. So she's chosen because they believe that she will be a sure vote for them. So, she is someone whose track record and background have indicated to the people who are making this decision that she will vote in their favor, meaning that she, in fact, has prejudged many of those issues. They are issues that she already has a view on. And in fact, I think that her answers to some of these questions are very narrowly drawn to be to be accurate, but misleading. So, for example, to say she's made no pre-commitment to the president to rule that way, that's a lawyerly correct answer, and it actually occludes the truth. She doesn't have to have made a promise to him to do that for him to believe that she's such a partisan, such a right winger, that she would rule in his favor. When she's asked the question about would she recuse from a case involving this election, since this president has said he's putting her on the bench in order to rule in his favor, the fact is that when she says, I can't answer that, I'll just follow the rules that apply, she's basically suggesting that that the recusal statute, which predominantly focuses on financial conflicts, in essence, would not actually apply. She'd apply the factors, such as does she have a financial conflict, and find that she does not, regardless of the actual conflict, which is the fact that there's an appearance of impropriety here. There's an appearance that the president is choosing his own referees to referee this election and try to subvert our democracy, and expressly, in his own words, try to stop the ballots from being counted, to try to not have a transition. There'd be no transition, in his view. Mm-hmm. And any judge, quite frankly, any nominee who would accept the nominee under these circumstances, this close to election, I think has demonstrated a willingness to be a political partisan player and be someone who's willing to let there be a dark cloud over the Supreme Court and over its legitimacy in order to have the power to make decisions like that.
Right. So Lisa Graves, yesterday on day two, Monday, when each of the members of the Senate Judiciary Committee got to make a 10-minute opening statement, the questioning round began yesterday with each of them getting a half hour. And it was very clear that all the Democrats were honing in on the Affordable Care Act. And for good reason, they were trying to rush through her confirmation to get her seated before November 10th, 1 week after Election Day, when they're already scheduled to hear the administration's challenge to the Affordable Care Act, and they want her vote to overturn it.
Was that a smart strategy, do you think? I mean, because it seemed like by the middle of the day yesterday, we're going, all right, we get the message. Did you get what they were doing?
Well, I think two things. One is because of her slipperiness, I think it's hard for some of these members to pin her down. She's, you know, she's determined to not be pinned down regardless of her actual practical record, and even where she has expressly stated her views, for example, about Roe v. Wade.
Yep.
Like she, you know, she's pretending like she's a blank slate when she's chosen, because she's not a blank slate, because she has very deeply, firmly held views that she is unlikely to waver from for the next 20, 30, 40 years on the court. She's only 48. She could serve past the year 2060.
Oh,
so I think that the senators were trying to make it clear to the American people that this isn't just a procedural argument or a procedural dispute over the timing of the election, although this is you know, foul. And it's a foul, quite frankly, in terms of the precedent, the traditions of the Senate, to have this confirmation hearing going forward at such a reckless pace.
Yep.
For a lifetime job where you can't, it's not like a piece of legislation that you can amend if you get it wrong. Removing a Supreme Court justice is very hard. It'd be very hard to impeach someone. And so this is a decision that could last decades. And it requires full transparency and full deliberation, and not this rush to put her, install her on the bench to play this role of a sure vote for the Republican Party, which is mm-hmm. what they, you know, have committed to trying to do in their own platform for the Republican Party.
So they're calling her out on it. Yeah.
When they had a platform. But the fact is that the Supreme Court is in a position, because of the efforts of these amicus briefs and these litigants that the right wing has, you know, kind of spurred forward, to try yet again to overturn the Affordable Care Act. And they're attempting to do this in the midst of a pandemic in which literally tens of millions more Americans will have pre-existing conditions as the course of this pandemic unfolds. And millions of Americans are relying on the Affordable Care Act for basic healthcare access, because so many Americans have lost their jobs.
That's right.
And so many other jobs are gig jobs that don't provide insurance or have adequate coverage. And so you have so many more Americans in need of access to healthcare and in need of these protections. And you have a partisan Republican majority that is attempting to destroy this law, which they've been unsuccessful in doing through legislation. They did not have the votes to overturn that law. And so now they're attempting to do it by judicial fiat and by this appointment, in part because Justice Roberts, though he's voted in cases in ways that are very destructive of Americans' rights, particularly voting rights and rights in our democracy, mm-hmm. on the ACA, he failed to deliver for them on overturning the ACA. And so they're trying to put her forward. And so I think it was fair and appropriate for the members to say to the American people who are watching this, mm-hmm. here's something huge that's at stake. And I also want to say, however, that I'm extremely appreciative of my hero, Senator Whitehouse.
Oh, I was going to bring him up. You jumped the gun on me, because I got to say, we're watching him. I thought, I even tweeted out today, he gets my MVP award. I thought he was awesome. And everyone else dealt with, really, the Affordable Care Act. Kamala Harris dealt with the woman's choice. She spoke about DACA a little bit. But Sheldon Whitehouse went in on dark money, and he went in hard, and he gave us all a lesson. He did it yesterday, and he did it today. But yesterday, I'm watching him, and he keeps referring to the research done by CMD. And it's like, that's Lisa. That was you. All the Koch brothers, all the exposés on the Koch brothers and Alec exposed and all that stuff. He called you out at least two or three times, and it was so good to hear. So he's now my hero, too.
Well, that's very nice of you to say, Nicole. You know, I did write a report last week about the role of these dark money groups in these amicus briefs, and the role of Leonard Leo, as well as some groups that are funded by Charles Koch in putting forth these cases to try to strike down our laws. And as Senator Whitehouse described it, as this flotilla of amicus briefs, as if they're all independent, when in fact they're often funded by the very same people, as well as some of the same people who are orchestrating these campaigns to capture our courts in terms of who gets on the bench in the first place. And so I think that he just did such a compelling job,
really did,
of describing both his, you know, life's work. Really, his book Captured is just a tremendously important book to read. He and his staff have worked so hard, issuing reports this year, report after report, about the capturing of our courts, about the impact on real people's lives. And I was certainly honored that some of the research that I've been doing at CMD and that I did this past week that I published with CMD, you know, was cited by him, because yes, it does really help shine a light on what's really happening to this capturing of our courts, just as the report from the Washington Post last May about Leonard Leo and this $250 million-plus dark money network it has been captured and, pardon me, has been, about the capturing, has been exposed. I think it's vital for the American people to understand what's happening, where, to simplify it, you have a person in the person of Leonard Leo, who's basically choosing who the president chooses from. And he's choosing people because, as he told the Council on National Policy last year, he is helping to foment a revolution, which he calls a revival, of the Constitution, that he calls the structural Constitution, which they describe as limited constitutional government, which really means limited democracy. And he said in that speech last year that none of the people, the funders in that room he was speaking to, had seen the kind of legal revolution that was about to unfold that for the past 100 years. So basically rolling back our rights to be before the New Deal, to the robber baron era, where we didn't have labor rights, we didn't have rights to regulate this pollution through government laws, through democratically passed laws, and more. And so, you know, that's one part. So one part is you have this one guy who's playing a key role in choosing who President Trump chooses from, and he doesn't file any financial disclosure forms because he's a quote volunteer. So we don't know his sources of income, but we do know that in 2018. After Brett Kavanaugh was nominated, Leonard Leo paid off his mortgage on his home. And then 24 hours before the confirmation vote, basically as the cloture was invoked on Brett Kavanaugh's nomination, Leonard Leo closed on a mansion in Maine, a 12-bedroom mansion across from the yacht club, a $3.3 million mansion that he has a mortgage on, but he paid a substantial amount down to buy that mansion. That was 2 years ago, right, last week.
And wasn't there a huge Kavanaugh debt that all of a sudden disappeared as well?
Well, separately, you know, there was a discussion in that confirmation hearing process of him, of Brett Kavanaugh himself having debt that went away. Yeah. And there's a, you know, troubling set of rules governing financial disclosures for judges that basically omit gifts from friends. And so, you know, that's very obviously troubling and suspicious. I think Congress should ultimately get to the bottom of that as well. But to the kind of A plus B plus C, as Senator Whitehouse described it more eloquently than me, you have this one person who's playing such a singular role in the selection process. Mm-hmm. Then that same person is playing a substantial and singular central role in orchestrating the money going to groups to run ads to try to force those people he's pre-selected to be confirmed. And then many of the groups that are involved in that are also involved in amicus briefs, bringing cases to that Supreme Court to rule in their favor. And as he described it, by their tally, by Senator Whitehouse's tally, it's an 80-0 record in some of these cases, right, that he has analyzed of them winning. And I would say to you also, Nicole, one of the things that people don't realize is that this Supreme Court, its jurisdiction is almost entirely discretionary. It has more than 8,000 cases typically a year where people are seeking a review.
Right.
It takes only about 80 of those cases. And it takes, and basically four judges on that court get to decide which cases they hear. And they only decide cases, they only take cases that they think they can basically win on, that they have a majority to vote on. So it's no surprise that this right-wing court has taken cases on Citizens United, for example, to strike down our campaign finance and anti-corruption laws, in the Shelby case, to take on reversing decades of precedent about the Voting Rights Act.
Yep.
And then suddenly, this past year, to decide that suddenly federal courts can't play any role in adjudicating cases challenging extreme partisan redistricting or gerrymandering. And so that's just the, that's sort of the tip of the iceberg. You have these justices basically deciding which cases they want to move the law in the direction that they think they have the votes to move it in.
Right.
And it is extraordinarily, in my view, partisan and political. And it's a concerted effort to take away the rights of the American people through judicial decisions while claiming they're doing it through so-called originalism or textualism when that's just false. False.
Right. Does an originalist believe in the amendments? I mean, I guess maybe Amy Barrett doesn't because she couldn't name the five protections that the First Amendment guarantees.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's really interesting to me because sometimes I'll say to people who are conservatives, you know, actually, I think I'm more of a textualist than you. For example, unlike Richard Nixon and Ronald Reagan and many of these Republicans, I believe that when the Constitution says you have a right to counsel, it means you have a right to counsel.
Yeah.
Gideon was rightly decided, and it's a damn shame that for more than 160 years in this country, people did not actually have that right to counsel honored. Likewise, equal protection of the law. The Constitution plainly says that people are entitled to equal protection of the law, but you know, for more than 100 years, or about nearly 100 years, I should say, the Supreme Court refused to enforce that to block segregation, racial segregation.
Right.
I think those words have some meaning.
They should.
On the Voting Rights Act. The Voting Rights Act could not be more clear about the necessity of having this pre-clearance process to protect people's voting rights from being taken away in states that had a history of taking away people's voting rights. But suddenly the Supreme Court decides to sort of read that language out of the law to advance its own agenda. That's John Roberts, by the way. And at a time in which since 2008, since the election of President Obama, we've seen a surge in efforts to suppress the vote and make it harder for Americans to vote. And so these decisions are decisions where you have a partisan appointed majority. Obviously, you know, all judges at the Supreme Court are appointed by a president of a particular party. Mm-hmm. But you have people who have been chosen with the guiding hand of Leonard Leo to advance the revolution and, quote, revival that he's salivating over. And you also have a reality of how this court has been packed, both through sort of the cruel hand of fate and through extreme partisan gamesmanship. So in my lifetime, over the last 52 years, there have been 15 nominations confirmed to the U.S. Supreme Court from Republican presidents, and only 4 nominations confirmed to the Supreme Court with Democratic presidents.
Wow. Wow. That's
and so
a
it's
big
sort of amazing
disparity.
That it's only been 5-4 because we just, you know, just we're lucky to hold on to 4. Now, if they hadn't stolen the seat that arose in 2016 that Merrick Garland was nominated for, right now the court would be split 4-4.
And
if they weren't in the process of stealing this seat right now, that has arisen just right before the election and proceeding with this reckless and unprecedented nomination hearing on the eve of the election day while the election is underway, Democratic appointees could hold a 5-4 majority on that court.
Right.
But no.
Right.
They don't want that because they want to destroy our rights, in my view.
Right. I agree. And we have to wonder the circumstances surround Justice Kennedy's retirement so suddenly. And there were curiosities surrounding it. I don't want to get into it now, but it didn't look... It looked like there may have been more to the story than just him saying, oh, it's time to spend more time with the family. But I'll leave it at that because I have no proof.
Well, I do think that, you know, one of the troubling things is this idea that the Republicans have really, it's sort of beneath the surface, but this idea that those seats in essence belong to the judge who was there.
Right.
And so for Kennedy, they chose his clerk.
Right.
And there was conversations about there was speculation, I should say, about whether that was part of the deal was that they would replace him with his own clerk.
Yep.
And here you have Amy Barrett being described quite expressly as in the mold of Scalia for
That's
whom
right.
she clerked. And so it's like
taking Ruth Bader Ginsburg's
seat. Yeah.
But this is Ruth Bader Ginsburg's seat. And she had said, she's on the record actually saying something when they were talking about, you know, filling Scalia's seat and saying, well, you know, it should be an equal swap, basically somebody who has his ideology. And obviously she's nowhere near Ruth Bader Ginsburg. She can't bask in her shadow. So Lisa Graves, we're getting close to the end of the hour. Let me ask you something. Is there anything that the Democrats can do? Is there anything we can do to stop her from being seated?
Well, I'm not sure, but I do think that, you know, people should be very troubled by her willingness to elevate the supposed supreme right to bear arms in this case that she decided, while minimizing the right to vote.
Yep.
Senator Durbin. Yeah,
he was great on that. Yep, he was excellent on that topic.
Yeah, the idea that the right to vote is somehow a collective right, so it can be easily taken away from you, but even if you're a felon,
you can have a gun.
Is really an extraordinary act of judicial activism that just epitomizes how narrow her perspective is in terms of the rights she wants to advance, like, the religious freedom in the First Amendment, but not necessarily the other freedoms.
Yep.
And the Second Amendment right over people's voting rights. I think people should be very worried, and I think this will need to be redressed if she is confirmed.
Oh, boy. It just goes from bad to worse to even worse. It's inconceivable. Lisa Graves, thank you so much for your input. You enlighten me all the time. I so appreciate it. Find Lisa
on your show.
Twitter, on Facebook, and visit TrueNorthResearch.org. That's where she's doing amazing stuff right now. Lisa, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks, Nicole.
Okay, bye-bye. And tomorrow, Howie Klein will be here. Have a great night, everyone. Keep the faith. Bye.